So, whom to thank, Margaret Atwood or the alien?
Well, how do you know which is which?
Okay, then I'll just thank you, okay?
Yes, just thank me, yes, that's a good form of address.
Because you're both, right? When you started to do your study on the...
human beings.
Yes, the Homo sapiens sapiens. Were you surprised about us or disappointed?
Well, I started a long time ago. So by this time, I'm neither surprised nor disappointed. I'm cautiously hopeful. As I say, you do have some good points. If you didn't have any good points, you wouldn't be doing the Nexus Institute, would you?
And my question is alluding to hope. You ended your speech on the presence of hope, and I know you've been writing for several decades on the human experience in general and the various hardships that people face due to social injustice. So I want to know if you feel more hopeful now or if you felt more hopeful earlier in your writing career, and if so, why?
Okay, so hope. First of all, hope is a built-in. I think it's just something human beings, by and large, come with, because if they didn't have hope back when it was time to hunt the gazelle, if they didn't get up in the morning and say, maybe there will be a gazelle today, they would not be our ancestors, because they would stop eating. So I think we're, and that's why apparently psychologists tell us that we prefer, in a landscape, we prefer a road that curves around out of sight than one that goes straight forward. Because if there's one that curves around out of sight, there might be something hopeful around the corner. Mm-hmm. So I think we have that tendency, and I think we need that tendency because it's motivating. Groundless hope, or having nothing but hope take the place of action, that's kind of useless. Mm. You know, if you lie in bed and think, I hope there will be a gazelle, you're actually not going to find one. So I'm hopeful in the sense of, I think people can be motivated to take actions that will improve their possibilities for the survival of the species. Mm. And I'm here to tell you, cockroaches are going to do just fine without you. It's not a question of them. And trees will probably be okay, or say plant life will probably be okay. They don't need as much oxygen as we do. But if the oceans die, that's 60 to 80% of the oxygen that we breathe is produced there. Same place it came from 1.9 billion years ago, replacing the original atmosphere of this planet, which was methane. So if you kill the oceans, first of all, we're going to get very stupid because we will have the same amount of oxygen you find on top of Mount Everest without an oxygen tank. And then we're going to have a lot of car accidents. And then shortly after that, we'll probably all wheeze to death, except a bunch of super rich people who are hiding out in caves with oxygen generators until that runs out.
Right.
So that's, you know, that's why I think we should turn our attention to solving some of these problems quite quickly.
Yeah. I would like to know if you are more inspired by the big history, by the big heroes, or the small history, the story of the small heroes. Anonymous heroes, actually.
Okay, so here's...
Thank you.
Here's my answer. There's four kinds of stories. This is a simplification. there's stories about ordinary people in ordinary times. There's stories about ordinary people in extraordinary times. There's stories of extraordinary people in ordinary times. And there's stories of extraordinary people in extraordinary times. So Star Wars is extraordinary people in extraordinary times. Domestic comedies are ordinary people in ordinary times. The Handmaid's Tale is an ordinary person in extraordinary times. So I tend to think that we're all, I don't know, maybe I'm wrong, but most of it are not, us are not superheroes, and we're not equipped with X-ray vision or any of those other things. We are doing our best in whatever circumstances we find ourselves in. And sometimes we're not even doing our best, sometimes we're just screwing up. So I'm more interested in those kinds of people. It's not that I don't like to read about superheroes from time to time, and I'd like to be able to fly around like a bat. who can tell, maybe in another life. But as it is, I think most people are dealing with somewhat limited circumstances with a somewhat limited toolkit.
I have a question about the future, since we've talked about hope, utopism, utopia, and optimism. My question is about the future. When we look at past events in history, many argue that history repeats itself. Seeing the events that occur in the news today, how do you see the future? Do you feel like we can avoid this? And are we smart enough to avoid this?
Okay, history never repeats itself exactly, but patterns are discernible. However, the age that we live in right now is unprecedented in history for a couple of reasons. Number one, we have more advanced technology than human beings have ever had. And that gives us both astonishing possibilities for positive change and astonishing negative abilities. We've got them both. So that has altered what we are capable of and what can be done. And the other thing that's different is, although people in the past have thought the end of the world was coming, they were wrong, because look, we're still here. We now have the capability of actually not blowing up the planet, but causing extinction for ourselves. And I don't think that's ever happened before. The human race has gone through bottlenecks in the past in which our numbers were greatly diminished, but those bottlenecks were not caused by the human beings of the time. You know what a bottleneck is, right? It's an evolutionary bottleneck. You go down to this much, you get through it, and then you come out the other end. So can we get through the bottleneck? I believe that we can. We're not there yet. We're not at the bottleneck yet. We have time. Great minds are at work. Ordinary people are concerned. And a lot of them are. And there is enough momentum to actually do it. So I think what you have to say to people who are interested in only making money, a great big pile of money is going to be no good to you if you can't breathe.
Thank you. Thank you for what, in all respects, was a magical lecture. It was a lot of magic here today. Part of the magic is that we had a turnout of so many people, 1,200. I will have some closing remarks, which I'll do from there. And so when Margaret takes her seat in the first row, please give her a very warm round of applause.